Actually making a movie without Michael, is that, I didn't know that was possible.
No, actually, we're working on that.
Okay.
We're trying to get him out for a few days, so, yeah, we can keep the streak going.
But yeah, I won't be in the pole position, you know, the main principal character. That right. won't be happening.
Correct.
I'll be a supporting character.
Correct.
If it happens.
So how did the two of you guys meet in the first place?
Prison.
Jesus. Really?
Here we go.
It begins.
We met at the Little Rock Airport. Was the first time we ever met, actually. I had a professor in college that had worked with Mike at the Sundance Labs, and he showed me these videotapes of Mike's work, and I said, you know, that's the guy. And when I wrote my first film, that same professor gave me his cell phone number, so I just called him and said, you don't know who I am. I'm a kid from Arkansas, but I wrote this movie for you.
I always answer my phone, too, even if it says private number or block. I know a lot of people, they won't answer the phone.
You always answer your phone?
I always answer my phone, because you know, it could be Jeff Nichols.
That's
I mean, it
true.
Might be a salesperson, or it might be my parole officer, or it might be Jeff Nichols.
Or it could be the media.
Yeah, or the media.
Ooh.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Do you enjoy media?
I do.
You? You're not just putting up with it? You actually...
Well, I have a lot of sympathy. I mean, these festivals, the journalists, they have to see all the movies, and then they have to try and interview all these different people, and they have to... I mean, it must be hard to keep track of, you know, it's like, oh, I'm talking to this person, and they're in this movie. How did I feel about that movie? Oh, I think I liked it. Maybe I didn't, you know. So anyway, I have a lot of sympathy for, it seems like it would be very taxing.
So you'd be sympathetic to Jessica, who had to figure out what movie she's in.
Yeah, yeah. It's a real roulette over there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which magazine cover, when you're walking down the street, oh look, it's Jessica again. You can't get away from
it. I just put my chips on, the movie probably begins with the word the in the title.
The yeah. Help.
The Help.
And four letters.
Yeah. Four letters.
Wow, we really missed the boat on that.
Yeah.
The Take Shelter.
The take shelter.
Just change it to
the taking of shelter. Yeah.
That's,
yeah.
Unfortunate for us.
So when did this script start for you, Jeff?
I actually wrote it in the summer of 2008. I'd been thinking about it for, you know, a good year leading up to that. And yeah, it took me probably about 3-4 months to write, which is actually fairly fast for me.
And it just came? It was easy?
Nothing's easy. Writing's not easy, but yeah, it, you know, it was a culmination of a few images. I was standing in my backyard, and I had this. I was struck by this image of a guy standing over an open storm shelter. That was the first thought I had for this whole thing. I was like, "What's he doing? Is he coming in? Is he, you know, is he going in? Is he coming out? Is there somebody else down there?" And then, you know, there were just these general feelings of anxiety and worry and trouble that. Felt like it was a subject worth making a movie about.
And how hard is it when you, as you're developing the script, to actually consider getting the movie made at some point? Or is that?
Well, that's exactly how I wrote my first film. Was okay, you know, we're gonna have two nickels to rub together, and so, you know, that film almost every scene takes place outside during the day, and I wrote it that way on purpose because I knew we would need to execute it quickly. With this, I kind of threw that out the window, obviously, and the biggest kind of hurdle. At the start of this was finding an effects company to come on board, even before I even bothered these nice people. I knew I had to get that element, you know, in place. Because I know how to make a cheap movie, but I don't know how to make, you know, a cheap effects movie.
So is it casting the effects company like casting an actor?
No, actually, that was just luck. My agent at the time represented the Strauss brothers, Greg and Colin, who run Hydraulics, which was our effects company. And he just basically asked him for a favor. And I was like, will you look at this script? Will you watch this guy's, you know, first film? And they really responded to it. And they came on board. You know, it was a handshake agreement from the beginning. They just said, yeah, we're going to make this work. Which is pretty remarkable, considering the amount of work they ended up doing.
Kind of fits the movie, though. Having a handshake agreement.
Yeah, right. Yeah, we were really lucky to have them involved.
So was Michael the first call, or was that... obvious, or
in this particular instance, I didn't write the part for him, but he's one of the first people I sent it to.
Well, yeah, you were like, can you read this? Because you know, like he says about writing, you know, the first thought he has after he's done writing, can you read this? I don't know if it's any good or not. You know, so he just wants somebody to read it and say that it makes sense or that it's coherent or something.
Right.
So that's what I did initially. as I said, you really need to work on this. No, I'm just kidding. I said,
this
it's great.
This needs another 6 months.
Yeah, this needs a polish.
So you say, I want to play this role? Are you thinking that and not saying it, or are you saying
no,
it?
No, I just say, I read it, I say, this is really great. It's going to be a great movie. And then we didn't talk for like a few months. And I don't beg for work. I'm just kidding.
but you're rather busy also. Yeah. You have a full schedule, it seems like.
Yeah. Well, and I thought it would be good. As much as I love working with Jeff, I thought it would be good maybe for him to work with somebody else. I mean, it might be fun because I'm a real ball buster. You know? So anyway, it was really out of the blue. It was really kind of shockingly out of the blue that you called me up one day and you're like, hey, I got the money. You want to do it? And it wasn't like a couple of months before we started shooting.
Yeah, because I don't think I'd been like, massaging the point at all with you or like, hey, I'm thinking about you. That's how it works. I just thought I had you in my back pocket. I didn't know it was so tenuous. I thought I could call you at any time and you would just rush to come work with me.
Right.
So
little did you know.
Lucked out there that you were
my
free.
Daily planner was a mess. I had to rip pages out.
I'm actually gonna
white
say
out.
Mike was extremely busy and he was I don't know.
I went straight from Boardwalk Empire, season one. 2 days later, I was meeting you for the first time.
And
I was like,
day.
We're married. Hi. Yeah. And we have a deaf daughter. Let's go. But it was awesome. It was awesome when we finally got started.
So you guys hadn't met in New York or anything before then?
Oh, no.
Run into each other in the...
No, I knew Mike's work.
I don't go to vegan restaurants. So.
Oh, be quiet. Why? Well, everyone, I don't want people to know I'm vegan, and everyone says it.
I'm sorry.
Of course, I knew of his work, and when the script first got sent to me, I was working with the Labyrinth Theater Company. So, your name was being bandied about, even though if you didn't realize it.
I hadn't told him yet.
Yeah.
Behind my back.
And so I asked everyone, yeah, he's a great actor. I just wanted to make sure he wasn't a son of a bitch,
And how'd that work out?
Good gamble. It's very, actually a very, very nice guy.
You were working with Phil.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we met, I feel like we met the day before we started shooting.
We don't rehearse
but
much.
And the first day we shot one of the very last scenes of the movie.
When we go to the psychiatrist and he's like, you need to go to the hospital.
Arguably one of the most important scenes in the film.
And so we knew, I think.
So we had a little prayer circle at his apartment. It's like, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay.
But we knew we didn't have time to like be polite. Mm-hmm. We just had to as soon as I met him, just gave him a big hug and tried to get as comfortable as I could with him.
Which is hard.
It's hard because he's intimidating.
Which was helpful because I'd actually never physically touched Mike at that point. So it was good she came in to.
It added a whole new dimension of physical contact.
It did.
In Shotgun Stories, nobody touched.
He didn't touch
another person.
Well, how hard is that really as actors to jump into something like that? I mean, usually on stage you have rehearsal, this relationship obviously.
It's the crux of the biscuit.
Yeah.
It's funny actually. I don't know if you remember this. But I had so much anxiety about it, and Jeff and I were talking the day before, and you weren't out yet. I was like, "Why isn't he here? If it's about marriage, we have to get to know each other." And so when I first met you, because I was so nervous to meet you, Mike's a very powerful presence, and when I went to give you a hug, the first thing you did was stick your hand out to shake my hand.
And
I looked at your hand and I was like, no, and I gave you a hug anyway.
You insisted.
I insisted that you had to touch me.
And that's where the bullying started.
Exactly.
We just kind of clicked into it.
Yeah.
Are you tired of being an intimidating presence? Would you like to be doing the Three Stooges movie or something?
They keep talking about doing that Three Stooges movie.
They've done it, I think.
They shot
They've
it?
Shot it now, yeah.
Who was it? Jim Carrey?
No, it turned out to be like unknown people, relatively.
That was the way to
still
go.
Still the Farrellys.
Yeah.
The old Farrellys, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, with Sean Penn, Benicio del Toro, and... Yeah, that would have been crazy. But I mean, do you want to do something silly? Or you bring a lot of intensity to the table?
No, I prefer to keep it serious. No,
he's so funny in real life.
In real life...
In real life.
In real life. You have a very unique
Like, in real life here at the Hotel Intercontinental. Where the stakes are high.
Driver.
People are dropping like flies. Yeah.
No, you're really funny. I think someone should put Mike in a comedy very quickly. Although you've done a couple of comedies.
Yeah, I did improv in Chicago. I mean, not very good improv, but I did it. I think a lot of that is just a byproduct. Like, I just get so damn focused when I'm working that it looks like I'm trying to melt an ice cube with my brain or something. But I'm really just like, what do I want? What am I doing? It's weird to me because it's always like, that's how I was always instructed on how to act. Like, you're supposed to have, you know, really high stakes and everything's supposed to be really important and you got huge conflicts and drama and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And then, so I'm like, okay, I'll follow those instructions. And then later on, I'd be like, so why are you always playing Stark Raving Lunatic? I'm like, I'm just following the rules. That's what they told me to do. You know, so, I don't know, maybe my head's too big or something.
You're the everyman in this movie. And actually, a lot of women that have seen this movie think you're very handsome in this movie.
I didn't have any makeup on this movie.
My wife's best friend thinks you're very attractive.
Oh, man. Like, all of my girlfriends are like, Mike Shannon in that movie is so gorgeous.
Damn.
Dreamy. Well,
dreamy. That's something to think about when I'm laying in my hotel room alone.
So your wife did the makeup on the movie?
No.
No, there was no makeup. Oh, there was a little makeup sometimes.
There was Julia.
Yeah, he hired a makeup person and wouldn't let her do anything. Because she read a lot of magazines, ate a lot of sandwiches in her sandwich
hole. It's a very natural approach to making movies. People don't wear a lot of makeup in real life, again.
Yeah. Except you.
Does what you shoot make a difference in that regard? Were you shooting digital? Were you shooting cellular?
I only shoot film so far. My next film's going to be on film. So, yeah. Although shooting on film, the reason why you shoot on film is because I think it has a really natural feel and texture. And, you know, what we're trying to do is get these characters and these situations to feel as natural as possible. So that extends into wardrobe and makeup and lighting and everything, you know, production design, camera movement. The whole idea is to try and, you know, make people forget they're watching a movie.
So if the actors didn't have a lot of time to hang out together and rehearse and do things like that, did they have a lot of time to talk to you about what the script, what was really going on and what was really not going on and what was the meaning of everything in this story?
You know, it's interesting. Kind of every actor I work with has a different, different way of going about it. Everybody's unique. Everybody's a unique personality. Mike and I, we don't really talk that much about what's going on. Until after it's done, and we have no options. And Jessica and I, we talked, kind of medium.
I remember the very first day of shooting. I wasn't shooting in the morning, just in the afternoon. I came in, it was at lunch with the two of these guys. I had my binder, and I opened the script, and I had all these notes. And then I looked at Jeff, and I was like, when do they have sex in the script? Mm. Like, when in their life are they intimate? Like, what's their relationship off the camera? And you were so embarrassed. Like, I think you're turning red right now.
You can't say sex.
Look at him.
This isn't on TV.
I do remember that.
Do you remember? Yeah. It was so.
I was staring at her holding the gas mask. I was like, yeah, that's a good question.
Yeah, like, because it informs everything in a relationship, whether or not a couple's having sex. So I'm the opposite of not talking. I love to talk about.
You're into research. You're like a big research actor.
Yeah.
And to Jeff's credit, like, there was not a lot of time. Like, we had 4 weeks and everything was going to disappear. So there's a lot of pressure, but if there were some times where you really wanted to talk things out, and Jeff always, he wasn't afraid to stop the clock for a minute, and which took a lot of, metal. I was going to say metal.
You were going to say something else.
Because most people would have rushed through it because they were scared they're going to run out of time or whatever. But Jeff,
Do you not like to talk about it? Do you want to?
No, I hate it.
Just focus in the
Leave the juice in the lemon, right, Jeff?
That's how he puts it. I don't think to this day I've ever seen Mike Shannon holding a script. I don't know where you go.
Neil
I don't
would
know
take my script sometimes, though. Yeah. He says that, and then we'd be on set, and then sometimes he'd grab my script and would look through my script.
What's or we'd look over and see there's again? A line on Jessica's arm.
Where did we say we had sex?
What did
we say we had sex? When was it? Before this line?
And after you blushed, did he come up with an answer to this question?
I think we actually went through the script with an ink pen and put hearts next to scene.
No, we did not.
This scene.
Then there's the shelter problem. Once you're in the shelter with a daughter, when do you have sex?
There could have been a heart by that scene.
No, there was not. I think for my character, I thought that they were only intimate one time.
In the
hole.
But, you know, it's not, you know, I don't know. It actually, if you look at the, you know, script day. You know,
this is the last thing you want to talk about.
Next topic.
I went through and tried to figure out when my character had a meal, when he was eating.
It was mostly eggs.
Eggs.
Yeah, I ate a lot of eggs.
Well, okay. I'm going to defend the egg thing for a second. The movie is cyclical. Yeah. It's about morning, it's about dreams at night, and then you wake up. So naturally, you know, it's about routine, and it's about how this man's routine changes throughout the course of this film. And so the routine at the beginning of the film, the same at the end of the film, feels totally different for this man.
I thought it was about one man's struggle against mental illness.
Right. Well, that's it.
I thought it was about marriage and family.
Look, these are complex, Faith. Independent films.
I thought it was about the apocalypse.
They deal with a lot, guys.
Thought it was about little was about Tova and her dog, Red.
Little Tova and her dog. Yeah, that was going to be the movie at one point, right?
Yeah, the little girl and her dog.
This would be a better movie if it was just about Tova and her dog.
Then it would be the Tova.
Yeah,
yes.
The Tova, exactly.
Tova and Kenny.
Mm-hmm. $160 million coming mm-hmm. your way.
Yeah.
So you, as a writer, you wrote this quickly. It, you know, came to you in a dream. Have you thought about all of that when you present the script, when you're ready to go make the movie? Or are you really just thinking about, it's here, this is what I'm shooting, I know this script kind of works?
If I understand your question.
I mean, is it too many hours in the editing room that you start analyzing the circles inside the circles, or are you doing
there's
that
a little bit of that. In post, there's a little bit of that. The trickiest thing with this film was the first cut came out to be 2 hours and 45 minutes, which was really surprising to me. I guess because my last film didn't really have much dialogue in it. Apparently dialogue takes up time. cut that out. So, in the editing room there was more, I don't know, more wrangling of the idea than I maybe wanted. But no, when we're on set, especially with a film like this that is at this budget level and has to be executed so quickly, for me, the script is the safety net. Because you're so tired and just kind of, I don't know, you're just so rushed in a lot of ways that the only kind of thing that I can trust is all the thinking that went into the script beforehand. So when snap decisions are being made, I just try and turn back to the script as much as I can. And then I have, you know, very intelligent actors there to help things that fall through the cracks. I mean, there was a specific scene, one of the more important scenes of the film, where Jessica's character slaps Mike. And I think in the script, you know, I just cut to later and she's in the house and, you know, the doorbell rings and she goes to get it. And Jessica was like, no, we can't cut this way, because when did she come home? Have they talked? You know, you can't jump time like that. And that's why it's important to have such intelligent actors working with you, because they think about, you know, they think about their character, you know, when they're not on the page. And sometimes, as a writer, I don't cover all those bases. And so we quickly modified that to have her coming in. And it, in the film, it doesn't, you may not really pay attention to it or not, but it doesn't slow you down. Whereas the other way might have felt a little more muddled.
Is there a lot of room for happy accidents or happy last-minute decisions as you're making an independent decision?
Yes and no. Yes and no. I mean, we stick pretty close to the script. That's not to say, you know, ideas don't flow and other things, but I'm pretty tethered to that script. But you have to, on an independent film, you know, like, we'd show up to locations that fell through the day before, and I'd never, you know, the first time I was in the space was the day we were shooting it. So in that sense, you have to be really malleable, but it's not like, hey, this storyline, let's delete this and come up with something new, you know? So it's more in the particulars, I think.
And how do you guys know that you're in the groove when you're in the midst of this? You just feel it when it's happening, or?
Well, I mean, I think for me, I could kind of tell it was going to be all right when it felt like that family bond got established. You know, we didn't get a lot of time beforehand to do that, but, you know, there were no trailers or anything. We were all together all the time, so. And when we were shooting at the house, we did that all in one big chunk and really got time to, we were always together and with Tova, and it was literally like it was our house and we were living there, and every once in a while someone would film something, you know what I mean? And that's when it started to feel really good to me, yeah.
Yeah, I still, I totally agree with that. And it was great to be in the scenes with Mike, because a lot of the times, sometimes we would only get three takes for an entire scene. Mm-hmm. And then I remember walking away, I've never shot like this, where you think, like, it wasn't covered. There's nothing to cut to. Yeah.
Three takes from one angle.
Yeah, from one angle.
And I do one in Spanish. So that
it's
eliminates
in his contract.
One. Yeah.
It's in his contract. Yeah.
Yeah. No quiero. No quiero más. Samantha.
So I always, I never felt like, we were gonna fail. Like I always felt like, no matter what happened, there were people protecting it.
They make fun of. Well, they don't make fun of it, but you know, they talk about the insecurity and doing that really important scene on the first day. But from my perspective, I was sitting back and I just felt like the luckiest guy in the world, because I saw the dynamic between the two of them. And I mean, there's something really awesome that happens when you've gone through and you've cast your film and. And then you get to see it just kind of come to life right in front of your eyes. And the two of them in that scene, despite the fact that I threw them, you know, in the deep end on the very first day.
Intentional or unintentional?
Totally unintentional. Independent filmmaking. But the dynamic was there. I mean, the way you lean over and you touch his hand, it felt right, you know, for me from the beginning. And the best thing, or maybe the only thing I can do for these guys is just let them know how I think their character's tracking, because we're going to shoot this thing, you know, upside down, inside out, totally out of order. And just to be able to hold in my head, like, oh no, that's how that scene was supposed to play. That's maybe the only, you know, really good thing I'm there for.
You guys were really good with me with, because basically Samantha's subtext of the film is, what's wrong with you? You know, and it's different levels of what's wrong with you. Why are you acting so weird? And when you're shooting out of sequence, like the kind of the sensitivity of how much that goes into play in the scene is really tough. But I was so stressed about it, nervous about it. But
because you didn't want to come off as being mean.
Yeah, or because if I'm playing everything, like, you know.
What's your problem?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So before every scene, we would talk about what has happened before, and
we kind of had to.
Yeah, we were, but not all directors and not all other, you know, scene partners do that. Sometimes people are all about their own performance or their own. They're just too busy.
Or not even that. They get scared, because, like I was saying earlier, on a set like this, I mean, I worked on something. Well, I shouldn't say, but where people are literally like, we don't have time. Like, we literally don't have time to shoot the scene. Like, and there's another scene after it. So, like, yeah. But anyway, I'm sorry.
But it's what you just said. Like, if you take the time, if you take the 10 minutes to talk about it, then what you're shooting is going to be better than if you are just, like, blindly fishing for something and you didn't take that time.
You can hopefully move on feeling like you've accomplished something.
And you can get it in three takes.
Right. Well, there's so many layers of anxiety going on in the script at the same time. You know, the deafness thing is there always as kind of a cloud, almost as much as the apocalypse is. I mean, it's, for me at least, I have a kid at home, so I'm like, that was heavy in that for that picture for me.
Health insurance and taking care of your family and your kids. Yeah, it's
and seeing that coming, you know, you anticipate it as you're watching the movie, that bad moment, that idea is, you know, as soon as you start announcing how many weeks it's going to be before the surgery or the months. You can feel the ticking time bomb.
Yeah.
And I hated I hated having to hit you after that scene.
I did it
because I asked them right beforehand. I said, Jeff, if you promise me we're only going to shoot this 3 times. You promise me right now, I'm only going to hit him in the face 3 times. I will hit him so hard because I will not be nervous. Like, you know, when you're hitting, you just don't want to think, like, how many times am I going to have to do this to him?
She smacked him.
Yeah, so 3 times he promised, and then he did it.
Then we went out and wrestled in the backyard.
No, afterwards I was like, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Not just Warrior 2.
Yeah. No.
Yes.
She's going MMA on us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So do you think she'll direct soon, guys?
No.
She asking you?
No.
I don't know. Those books feel like directing. It's like I'm just a corner away, right around the...
Those books?
Your analysis of your...
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The detail you put into everything?
Yeah.
I'm not a good director. I wouldn't be a good director.
I don't think that's true. It's a piece of cake.
Maybe for you.
So how did you meet Jessica?
I met Jessica through our executive producer, Sarah Green. She produced Tree of Life. And you know, she said, you really need to meet this actress. And I flew out to LA and met her. And she was lovely. But at that point, she was lovely.
Before she changed.
Yeah. Before I put her through the hardships of making this film. No, it was great. But I still really hadn't seen... any of her work.
There's no footage at that point, yeah?
She's like,
I've been in movies, I promise.
I know. I've been working for 4 years.
People say you're good. But on set, and really, it was kind of in the same scene that I was talking about earlier. Like, as soon as she started, you know, there's something going on. I don't know. You just know it when you see it. I knew it with Mike in those original videotapes I saw, and I knew it as soon as she showed up on set. And, you know, it's just... I don't know. It's kind of an undeniable thing that happens when people start to emote things on camera without it seeming like they're doing much.
Do you think you have a unique eye for talent because people have emerged from your work, or is it just that they happen to be that good?
I don't know. For me, it's just kind of a no-brainer. You know, you watch films and you know you read it. It's just like Jessica Chastain stands out in this role. Mike Shannon does this, and then it's like, well, why don't we put those people in the lead roles? That's a good idea. It seems kind of like a no-brainer to me.
Do you have any urge to make the bigger $50 million drama?
Just depends on the terms, you know. The only way that I can protect the longevity of my career is to have some kind of say-so in the end product. So, and they don't like to give that to people too often.
Some kind of say-so or absolute say-so?
We're working on absolute say-so right now. But, you know, it's... I definitely have a desire to have more time. That's all I really want. Of course, time is money, all of that, but more time to execute these ideas, you know, so we don't have to feel so rushed. But who knows, maybe I'll look back one day and say, I want to go back to 4 6-day weeks.
So was Sundance the first time you guys saw the movie in front of an audience? How was that experience like the first time?
Oh yeah, it's great. I knew though, it's funny, before I came to this set, I'd been working a lot, and I was really tired. I was kind of like, I called my agent, and I was like, I need to take a year off of acting because I don't love it anymore. And then I was like, okay, I'm going to go do this movie. And then it was first day on set, and I was like, I knew that the movie was going to be amazing. I could tell, like, the dynamics were right. There was a really interesting viewpoint. I was like, the whole time we were making this movie, I was like, this is going to be phenomenal. I don't have that very often where I think
like
that.
Birth of a Nation.
And for you, Michael, do you like seeing yourself on screen?
But anyway, what's the end of that? What's the end of that story? You felt that way, and then you saw it, and you were like...
No, I knew.
I should have taken time off before that.
No, the first time he showed it to me, I didn't even realize. Like we were watching it, and he was so nervous to show it to me, and I told Tom, I was like, yes, it's exactly what I knew it was gonna be. It's not. Of course, I'm not surprised. I was there watching your performance, and so I knew how amazing your performance was because I had like the best seat in the house, and I knew. The story was interesting that he was going to tell. So for me, when I saw it at Sundance, it wasn't shocking. When it won the Grand Prize in American in Critics Week at Cannes, and of course it's wonderful. But I'm like, of course, yes.
You're like my dad, you know. Like,
Faith.
I was like, of course you won. Of course you won.
And what are you going to do next? Now you've won several awards. What's next?
No.
I don't know. It was weird for me watching it at Sundance because it was like it was such a private thing, and now all these strangers are like watching. It was like, because it was like I was saying earlier, it got to a point where it just felt like we were together, and then every once in a while we were making a scene, you know, filming a scene, and so it was weird sharing that with the, like anytime I saw a BlackBerry or, you know, somebody lean over and whisper, I was like,
or even cough,
yeah,
or something.
Yeah. I'm gonna pull out my machete. No, I'm just kidding.
Do you always carry a machete or just at Sundance?
Just at Sundance, yeah.
To hack through the snow.
Yeah, that and my skeet shooting. That's what I love about Sundance, skeet shooting.
True.
Yeah.
Of course, now you have the power to fly, so.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like a whole other guy.
Yeah.
But that's another interview.
Oh wait, I'm not supposed to say whether I can fly or not. I can't. I give up.
Oh no!
You tricked me. That was tricky.
Oh no!
In Zach's movies, everybody can fly all the time.
That's true. That's true. Or at least jump really high.
Yes. Yeah. Super jumping.
Yeah.